Hello, I'm Dr. Dennis McKenna, as always joined by Dr. Fred Venditti, our Hospital System General Director. Today's Thursday, August 19th, giving you the update from Albany Med. All right, Fred, a lot to cover.
Yes.
Pop open the first graph here. People in the hospitals of the Capital Region with COVID, that number is 106. I'm going to come back to that number in a couple seconds there. Next chart here is admissions and discharges to the medical center. You can see, Fred, if you look closely all the way to the right, about 2 to 3 per day coming in.
That's right.
If there's any good news in that story, and I think there is, over the last 7 days, we've had 18 come in and 18 come out.
That's right, Dennis.
So over the last 7 days, kind of in a homeostasis, as they call it.
We're in balance.
We're in balance. Next graph, the morning census here at the medical center, currently 25. Let's break that number down a couple different ways. 15 on the floor, 10 in the ICU, 2 on the ventilator.
That's right.
And the breakdown of the 25 is 24 adult and 1 peds. And I know, Fred, from time to time we talk about other types of respiratory viruses. There's currently 3 in the hospital with RSV. That may be interesting to some people as we watch and see what happens with RSV season.
It's unusual because right. It's not something we typically right. see much of in the summer.
So going back to that 106, Fred, we thought it would be interesting to compare this, to talk about what we're seeing today and how that compares to in the past.
That's right.
Today we have 106 people in the Capital Region in the hospital, of which 22 are in the ICU. How many of those are on a ventilator about?
Less than half, Dennis. We know that from our regional call.
So if you go onto open source data, if you go to the New York State Forward website, this is where we pull all this data, and you can see a graph. I went back and found another time in the beginning of the pandemic where we had basically the exact same number of people in the Capital Region admitted, and that was back on April 1st, 2020. So over a year ago, we had 105 in the hospital beds of the Capital Region. At that time, 45 were in the ICU. Today we have 22, and by memory,
more than half of those patients were on right. ventilators.
So Fred, what does that mean if we have the same number of people as we did before, but about half in the ICUs? How would you interpret that?
So Dennis, we've talked about this before. It really ties back to vaccination. So the vaccines decrease the likelihood of getting the COVID right. infection. And also, if you get COVID, you're less sick. So you're less likely to be hospitalized.
Right.
And if you are hospitalized, you're less likely to be severely ill, i.e. in an ICU, or on a ventilator.
We're talk a lot about vaccine, but let's take this moment right now. You were on a call today with the New York State Commissioner of Health, Dr. Zucker. He was talking about how the likelihood of getting hospitalized changes if you're vaccinated or not. And the number's pretty dramatic.
It is, Dennis. So he was referring to a study that was published yesterday in something called the Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Report of the
right.
CDC, which is the New York State experience,
right.
14 million people in this. And basically what they show is that if you're vaccinated, you have an 11-fold reduced risk of being hospitalized and an 8-fold reduced risk of getting COVID.
Excellent.
So
okay.
The vaccines really work, and that's our own data.
That's our own data.
Dennis. That's all of us
that's right.
in that data set.
In that data set. So let's talk about here in the Capital Region. 713,000 have received vaccine in this area. If you look at the population 18 and above, currently we're at about 72% who have received at least
That's
the
right.
first shot. And here's some good news here. Over the last 7 days, we've had over 8,000 people who've started to get the vaccine. So we are starting to see those numbers go up. A reminder, capitalregionvax.org is really the single source you need to go to depending on the county you're in as far as finding vaccine availability.
Yes.
So Fred, members of our workforce, there are some that up to this point have not yet been vaccinated. So I believe there's an opportunity for them to do so tomorrow.
That's right, Dennis. So we're running a clinic again tomorrow from 7 in the morning until 11 in the morning down in the BE lobby where
okay.
we've done these clinics before. We're going to be administering Pfizer vaccine, first and second doses, for those people who haven't been vaccinated yet. We're not going to be doing booster shots there, so it's important not to show up thinking you can get a booster shot. We're not quite ready to do that. You probably have heard that the government, HHS, is recommending booster shots. That'll be later in September, so we'll plan for that, and we'll sort out how we're going to do that for our employees.
Okay, so more on boosters in the future.
That's right.
No boosters tomorrow, but first dose or second dose, 7 a.m. to 11 a.m., BE entrance.
BE entrance. And it's really important. If you've not been vaccinated, please think long and hard and show up tomorrow and get your vaccine.
And that's for our workforce?
Our workforce.
Okay, very good. Now, Fred, obviously that's a perfect segue into the next topic, which is that as we've talked about in this video, and as I think our workforce knows, we've gone forward as a region, as a health system that said the vaccine would be mandated, consistent with what we've done in the past with the flu vaccine.
That's right.
New York State has now recently come out as well and said it will be mandated as well. Any update as far as our position, New York State's position, and looking at the two together?
So last night, Dennis, around 7:30, the commissioner pushed out to all the hospitals and nursing homes in the state something called an order for summary action, which basically is his rule set that goes into effect. And that requires vaccination for all healthcare workers, unless you have an appropriate medical exemption or religious exemption. And there's no alternative. So masking with serial testing is not an option. You have to get vaccinated. So we've got to compare that to our policy.
Right.
There may be some differences and we may have to alter our policy, but we'll see. You know, literally just came out last night.
Okay. I'm sure the same is true for you, Fred. Members of the workforce have reached out to me specifically to talk about their specific situation. I begin by thanking them for reaching out to me. I consider it to be a privilege to try to answer their questions. I think the best and preferable way for somebody to look for a medical or religious exemption is through a process, which I know we've published on the intranet. Perhaps we'll put that out again, but there is a way. So an email or a phone call to us, we can point them in the right direction.
Right.
We want to be sure they get a full review. Multidisciplinary group.
That's right, Dennis.
Made up of several different individuals looking at that.
That's right. It is on the website, two different forms to have filled out if you want to be considered.
Right. Fred, people may have heard that we opened up incident command last Friday. Can you explain the logic behind opening that up and what it is we're looking to do with incident command?
So, Dennis, we've used incident command in the past as COVID has increased in numbers, and that's happening again. So we're using it as a way to be very quick on our feet for changes that we need to make to respond to the surge that we're seeing now. So we've seen fairly dramatic increase in inpatients. We had one inpatient.
We were down to one.
Back in early July, and now we have 25. So that's part of it. We've also seen a fair number of our staff, I think today we're at 70.
70 is the working number.
Yeah, who are either positive from exposures or are unvaccinated and exposed and therefore have to be quarantined.
Right.
That's not our decision anymore. That's an OSHA requirement. So we're using incident command to deal with all the issues that the COVID surge has created for us in a quick, efficient way.
All right, very good. And as things or changes come out of there, we'll bring them back here as well.
Absolutely.
Very good. Fred, shifting gears, I see you have a white coat on.
I do.
White coat, of course, is the visual symbol often of people in medicine, doctors.
Yes.
Recently, the college had its white coat ceremony, and I want to congratulate the classes of 2024 and 2025. They weren't able to do it last year.
That's right.
So both the first and second years went through it. Dr. Vidal, Dr. Cosgrove led them through that really important symbolic moment. Fred, what is the white coat ceremony?
So, Dennis, the white coat ceremony is actually sort of the introduction of medical students into their medical education. Mm. And it's kind of a solemn event. And both the ceremony and the coat have meaning, okay? This is something that was first put forward by the Arnold P. Gold Foundation in 1993. And medical schools now around the country do this. The students receive the coat as a symbol of their fidelity to their discipline, to their profession. They take an oath, that's very important. And, again, it's very solemn in terms of their commitment to their profession and their patients. So it's starting them on their journey into the profession of medicine.
So you mentioned it started in 1993, so neither you nor I were able to do that back in the day, but
that's
a great event.
It is.
And it's another moment where it distinguishes what happens on this campus, really from anywhere in the region.
That's right.
Having the medical college is so special, so congratulate to those students.
Congratulations.
So speaking of our great dean, Dr. Verdial, he was on the radio today, WAMC, with Dr. Alan Shartok.
Yes.
And he did an interview.
He did. So I think he talked about his tenure as dean. So Dr. Verdial is one of the longest serving deans in the country. has done fantastic things both in medical education, research, and clinical work here on the campus. So this is sort of in recognition, an opportunity for him to talk about some of those things with Alan.
The link will be sent out. We'll be sure our workforce who didn't get a chance to hear it when it occurred will get a chance to watch it when they get the moment. So congratulations to Vince. And WAMC as a radio station started.
Started, yes.
Albany Medical
That's
College.
Right.
So it comes full circle.
It does.
All right, very good. We're heading into the weekend. It's going to be maybe a little rainy.
Yeah.
However.
There's a tropical storm.
Yeah, what's it called?
For that.
Yeah.
I think it's called Fred.
It is.
Yes.
Hurricane Fred.
Hurricane tropical. Fred.
You're more a force of good, not destruction.
Thank you, Dennis.
Yeah. But despite the fact that it's raining, we still know that we'll be up and running 24/7 delivery of care around the clock. We always thank our staff for being here.
Yes.
And we'll be back again next week.
Yes.
All right, very good. We ask that you once again, please take care of yourself, take care of each other, and we'll see you next week.